Welcome to Module 3, Pain Assessment Using Behavioral Screening Tools. The focus of this module is for all certified nursing assistants and provides information about your role in helping to screen for possible pain in residents that can't communicate. The objectives for this module are to describe the role of the CNA in pain assessment for residents unable to report pain, to identify behaviors to watch for that might mean that pain is present in residents unable to self-report their pain, and to describe two assessment tools that can be used for screening residents that are not able to self-report. What is pain? Pain is anything the patient says it is. It's important that we believe our patients or our residents when they tell us that they're having pain, and self-report is the best way to do that. So asking patients or residents about pain is the first step. But what do you do when residents can't tell us about the pain that they're experiencing? This is one of our biggest challenges, and one that you, as a CNA caring for older persons that have cognitive difficulties, play a very important role. Pain assessment for residents not able to self-report. Self-report means that the resident can tell you about their pain. For residents that cannot self-report, we need to watch for signs of possible pain, and this involves always paying close attention to what's going on in that person's life. What behaviors are they showing, and what changes are you seeing from their normal behaviors that might be clues that something is going on? For residents not able to self-report, we know that there are specific behaviors that are common when people experience pain, and these are much easier to identify and to see, such as grimacing or wincing. They are grab or brace or guard an area that's painful, or they may rub an area that's hurting them, or they may call out or groan or moan or cry. When we see these behaviors, it's pretty easy to think that this person's probably hurting or having pain. But besides these, there are other behavior changes that may occur in people that can't self-report that are less easy to understand or to recognize. And these are changes in their normal behaviors or activities, such as a change in energy. Maybe they're more fatigued or tired or napping more, or maybe they're not sleeping. Maybe that's a major problem. Or they lose interest in being involved in the activities that they normally participate in. Or they may be angry or striking out or resisting care. Maybe changes in appetite, they're not eating as much. Subtle things that may not immediately make you think about pain, but these changes could be indicators of a pain problem that's not yet been recognized. So what's the role of the certified nursing assistant in helping to screen or assess for pain in residents that are unable to self-report? You play a very important role. You are the ones who are the most close to the residents and spend the most time with them to really be in a position to observe and report signs of pain or possible pain problems. So observing and reporting when you see behaviors that you think are pain related, observing and reporting if treatments for pain seem to be helping, are you seeing a change in those behaviors? And also observing and reporting for side effects of treatment, such as pain medications, that may need further follow-up or treatment. So what all can the CNA do? You certainly can watch for possible pain during movement. This is often when indicators of pain or behaviors of pain most commonly show themselves, maybe in the morning cares, doing their bath, doing range of motion, turning, ambulating, getting out of bed. Anytime that the older person is engaged in an activity that's going to move joints or could make a painful area hurt is the best time to be watching them for behaviors that might be pain related. It's also important to get information from people that know the resident well. If you're new to the care of the resident, talking to the other CNAs that have cared for this person before can be very useful, or talking to family members, trying to get information about what their normal behavior is so that you're able to recognize changes that are clues that there's a problem that might be pain-related that we need to evaluate further. You may be the first person to see a behavior that's not normal or a change in their behavior that requires further evaluation. In the pain assessment process, observing is just a very key element that you as a CNA have the perfect position to be doing. And the things that you should be thinking about are, you know, what behaviors do you see that might be pain-related? And when do you see those behaviors? Are they related to a certain activity, certain time of day? These aspects of a pain screen or assessment are very important. Let me give you an example. Betty Smith is a resident that you've worked with many times, but she's very confused and very unable to communicate with you and tell you whether or not she's hurting. So today, during Betty's shower, you notice that she's holding her arm against her chest, and she makes a noise whenever you try to move it to wash under it. So think about Betty's response in the shower. Have you ever seen Betty act like this before? Did you notice any other behaviors that were out of the ordinary? Did you notice any areas on her body that look different? Are there any areas of redness or bruising that could be important to identify if there's been some injury? This is all about a part of being a good observer, putting together this information. And the next step is most important. Doing the observing is the first step, but it needs to be communicated. So reporting what you've observed is another key element of your activities in recognizing pain in older people that can't self-report. So what do you report? What you saw? When you saw it? Things that are not normal for that resident all need to be communicated and reported. When do you report? Is it something to report immediately? If it seems clear to you that the person is experiencing behaviors or changes that might be pain-related in an acute fashion, means current and right away, then you need to report it immediately. But sometimes it may be that your procedure in your facility is to report those changes at the end of an activity when you've finished with a bath or an ambulation, or sometimes at the end of the shift. A process needs to be developed in your facility so that it's clear when you report and what needs to be reported. And then who to report to. Typically, you're going to report this type of information to the nurse in charge so that she can follow up with a more thorough assessment and evaluation. But it's important to follow whatever the procedure is that your nursing home establishes for pain assessment. So, how can you help screen for pain? CNAs have an important role in regularly evaluating your residents, looking for changes that might suggest the presence of a pain condition. Pain screening is a review of the resident's behavior that might show whether or not they're having pain. And again, it's focusing in on specific behaviors. The screening process is one element, an important element, of your role and how you can contribute to recognizing pain in your residents. So when should screening be done? Pain assessment is done at several different times during the stay of a resident. On admission, all residents are screened for pain or assessed for pain. They're also evaluated again anytime there's a change in their condition, anytime that you think that there might be pain, and at least quarterly, because it's important to keep up regular evaluation and monitoring of residents and changes that might be occurring in their condition. Well, how can you help screen for pain? How can it be done? there are checklists of behaviors, such as in the MDS, that list things to be looking for and monitoring for that might be pain-related. Another strategy is to use a pain behavior tool or checklist that's been developed for the purpose of helping us to recognize pain in older people with dementia or unable to communicate their pain. There are many tools that have been developed and available, but we're recommending two tools that could be incorporated into your facility that have been validated and shown to be easy to use and time efficient in establishing a good screening process. And I'm going to share a little bit about those two tools and how they might be used by you in your facility. Having a consistent way of screening for pain, a consistent tool, is really important because it helps to monitor pain over time and it helps to communicate information that's needed so that we're looking for similar behaviors to determine if pain is getting better or worse. So what do you need to know about using a screening tool? Well, screening tools help to establish a baseline or a score for each resident on behaviors that are known to be pain-related. It's important to get information not only from your own observation, but from caregivers who know the resident well if you don't. It's also important to use the same screening tool. It doesn't help to use one tool before we identify pain and then after treatment to use a different tool. We can't determine if our intervention has improved the pain problem. So identifying the tools for your facility are important, and then using the same tool over and over across provider and across shift is one way to assure that we're being consistent and that we're communicating well what we're seeing in our residents. The two tools that we're going to share are the PainAD and the PACSLAC, and these are two tools that have been validated and tested for use in nursing homes. Before using any screening tool, it's important to have training on the use of the tool, practice on using the tool to make sure that you're using it correctly, to compare your findings in using the tool with others to make sure that everyone that's using the tool is using it the same way. So if there are items on the tool that are confusing, talking about those and asking questions to make sure that you know how to use the tool effectively. The PainAD, or the Pain Assessment in Advanced Dementia instrument, was developed to assess pain in older adults who have dementia or cognitive impairment or a limited ability to communicate, and it could be used on a daily basis or as needed when pain is suspected. But it's a short, simple checklist or tool that scores behaviors on a 0-1-2 basis. The next slide shows you what the tool looks like. As you can see, there's five categories of behavior: breathing, negative vocalization, facial expression, body language, consolability. And each of these categories is rated a 0, a 1, or a 2. And you can look across the tool to see how the different levels or scores indicate higher levels of discomfort. So you score each category, a 0, a 1, or a 2, and then create a total score. So how do you use the PainAD? Well, first of all, it's important to watch the resident, both at rest and when moving. We know that when the resident is at rest, you may not see pain behavior, so it's important to observe during movement as well. After observing the resident, look at the list of behaviors and score each category a 0, a 1, or a 2 to match what you saw in the resident's behavior. Then total the score and you'll get a total for the tool. That score can be compared then to earlier evaluations and can help identify if there are changes in behaviors that suggest that the resident has pain. A higher score suggests an increase in pain is likely. A lower score suggests that the pain is likely to have decreased. Thus, using a tool with a scoring system helps to recognize when pain is increasing or decreasing and can be important to us in evaluating whether or not the person has pain or if they're responding to treatment effectively. Another tool is the PACSLAC. That stands for Pain Assessment Checklist for Seniors with Limited Ability to Communicate. This tool is actually a more comprehensive list of behaviors. There are 60 items on it, but it's very quick to complete once you are familiar with the behaviors on the tool. And it may help to identify pain in residents where the common, more specific pain behaviors are not present, when they have more atypical types of behaviors or changes in their normal activity. There's 4 subscales, one that focuses on facial expressions, one on activity or body movements, one on social or personality changes, and one on physiological indicators, appetite, and sleep. Here's an example of some of the behaviors on the PACSLAC. As you can see, there's a number of different types of behaviors under each of the subscales that you look for when you're working with the resident, again, both at rest and during activity. How do you use the PACSLAC? Very similar to the other instrument we discussed, watch the resident at rest and activity, describe if they are, or decide if they're having behaviors on the checklist. For this tool, it's not a rating of 0, 1, 2, but is the behavior present or absent? So you indicate that with a check mark and then total the score. And again, the information on the tool is compared from time to time to see if the number of behaviors increases or decreases, suggesting that pain has increased or decreased. One important element of using a behavior screening tool is documentation. Documenting or recording the scores in a location that can be seen by all staff. It's important to be able to score the tool each time it's completed, both at baseline so that we know where the resident is initially, and then over time so that we can track changes in behavior to be able to recognize when a resident that may have been pain-free all of a sudden has a change in behaviors that may suggest a pain problem that needs to be identified and treated. The takeaway messages for this session are that pain assessment has to be done regularly. Residents that can't self-report need your help in recognizing and identifying behaviors that may be pain-related. It's important to watch residents for behaviors that are not normal or a change from their typical behavior, as this is one way to identify pain in those that can't communicate. As a CNA caring for residents in your facility, you may be the first one to notice pain behaviors in your residents. Not just noticing them, but importantly, communicating and reporting those behaviors to someone such as the nurse, who can then follow up with a more detailed assessment and evaluation of what may be an unrecognized pain problem. So you do play a very important role in screening and using screening tools to monitor for changes in your residents that might be pain related.